O próximo diálogo global coloca-nos perante a questão se podemos, de facto, mudar o mundo. O envolvimento cívico e o ativismo de base estão a mudar as suas formas de criar impacto na sociedade, adaptando-se às novas tecnologias e formas de comunicação. Ser-se convencional deixou de ser a norma. Vimos isso mesmo pela forma como Edward Snowden conseguiu estar connosco aqui no Estoril. O próximo painel é moderado pelo jornalista António Mateus, editor de Internacional da RTP. António. Contamos com dois oradores, que passo desde já a chamar. Joséphine Goube, colocada no ano passado pela Forbes na lista dos 30 empreendedores sociais com menos de 30 anos pelo seu trabalho no Migrate, uma plataforma que fornece aos migrantes acesso ao apoio à migração. Esta jovem ativista francesa é a CEO da Techfugees, uma associação sem fins lucrativos que coloca o enorme poder da tecnologia ao serviço do setor humanitário. Há dois anos, foi nomeada especialista em imigração pela Comissão Europeia. Joséphine. Alberto Alemanno é professor de Direito na Escola de Altos Estudos Comerciais em Paris. Ao longo dos últimos anos lançou empreendimentos sociais com o objetivo de promover novos caminhos de envolvimento com o processo político. Aconselha ONGs e governos um pouco por todo o mundo, assim como organizações internacionais, tais como a Comissão Europeia, o Parlamento Europeu, a OCDE e a Organização Mundial de Saúde. António.
Boa tarde. É um prazer e um privilégio estar aqui convosco hoje à tarde e darem-nos o vosso tempo, a vossa sensibilidade e o interesse naquilo que podemos todos partilhar. Eu vou falar só um bocadinho em português, depois para a compreensão global dos nossos convidados de hoje, obviamente mudo para inglês. Só para vos dizer duas ou três coisas. Como pontapé de saída desta participação neste debate. Foi um privilégio enorme nos bastidores conhecer os dois membros deste painel. São pessoas extraordinárias que nos despertam não só um positivismo cada vez mais urgente no mundo à nossa volta, como também uma fé enorme no indivíduo e na capacidade do indivíduo de mudar para muito melhor o mundo em que navegamos todos os dias. Nós ligamos os telejornais de todos os canais do mundo e só dá vontade de desligar o botão passado uns 30 segundos. Eu sou pai de dois rapazes e quase tenho vontade de meter uma bola vermelha no ecrã como jornalista, porque não é aquele o mundo em que eu quero viver, não é aquele o mundo que eu quero deixar aos meus filhos, não é esta construção de muros entre nós que este mundo precisa. Os tijolos que nós usamos e que alguns líderes políticos, nós sabemos quais, cada vez mais, que querem construir muros de suposta segurança, deveriam usar os mesmos tijolos para construir pontes entre nós, pontes de nos aproximarmos, pontes de nos abraçarmos. Só que essa não é a escolha. E cabe-nos a nós inverter essa escolha, a cada um de nós. A vida deu-me muitos privilégios. Eu costumo dizer que tive duas bênçãos na vida, além dos meus filhos e da minha mãe e do meu pai. Tive duas grandes bênçãos. A primeira, certamente, que foi ter andado durante 10 anos com Nelson Mandela enquanto jornalista, todos os dias. E o banho de humildade e humanismo que aquele homem nos emprestava no seu dia-a-dia. E não era pelos títulos que os jornalistas escrevem, não era por perdoar, como é tão fácil acreditar, não era nada disso. Acreditem, a coisa mais linda que aquele homem tinha era ser um ser humano, era governar por uma coisa tão estranha, que é governar como nós somos pais. Nós não precisamos de um guião para sermos pais, pois não. Nós governamos a nossa casa com o condimento e o tempero mais fácil de todos, que nasce aqui, nasce no nosso coração. Ninguém precisa de nos explicar, ninguém precisa de nos dizer estás bem, estás mal. O outro foi ter tido um cancro, foi ter sobrevivido a um cancro e ter percebido que nós não somos nada, mas nada, absolutamente nada, a não ser a pegada que deixamos atrás de nós. E que mesmo essa o vento um dia apagará. Cumpre-nos a nós fazer essa diferença. Não me interessam os políticos. Não me interessam os meus editores. Interessa-me o meu coração, interessa-me o meu estender da mão. Estes dois, a Joséphine e o Alberto, passado 5 minutos de nós estarmos sentados ali naquela sala, nós já falávamos a mesma língua, sendo ela francesa e ele italiano e eu português. Então, se nós que nunca nos vimos, olhem as carinhas deles, eles estão a olhar para mim e estão a sorrir. Não foi preciso mais nenhum tempero. Foi preciso eu dar-lhes o meu coração. Só isto. Quantos jornalistas fazem isto? Quantos políticos fazem isto? A escolha é de quem? É deles. Mas quem são os eles? Nós vivemos num planeta de ETs. O eles somos nós. A escolha é nossa. Não é? Eles dedicam a vida a promover essa escolha. Eles dedicam a vida àquilo que um senhor vagamente conhecido, chamado Gandhi, nos disse. Começa em ti a mudança que sonhas para o mundo. Não são os outros, somos nós. A Joséphine, daqui nada, obviamente como cavalheiro vou pedir à senhora, primeiro, para nos dar o privilégio de partilhar connosco o caminho que ela tem feito. A Joséphine vai-nos mostrar como ela, com os anos de vida que tem, já teve um impacto tão lindo, tão agregador no mundo à nossa volta. E essa é uma prenda de vida que eu peço à Joséphine para nos dar agora.
Thank you. I don't. Yeah. Thank you for such an introduction. Hi everyone. As you know, my name is Joséphine. I'm a CEO of Techfugees. We are a global non-profit, present in 25 countries through ambassadors, all volunteers. And we are empowering the displaced with technology. We started in September 2015, so we're very young as an organization. And we were started on the idea that a lot of people want to do something or felt powerless with the situation with refugees. And me and some other friends that I had, plus contacts and networks, we're all working in technology. And we're not humanitarians. We're not doctors. We're not professional social workers. So we thought, what can we do with our tech skills? Because we know that technology scales. And from that conversation, we started an event. 300 people showed up and they discussed. It was refugees, NGOs, techies discussing what tech can do to help the refugee situation. If we can't be doctors and saving lives, we might be able to provide communication tools for those doctors to communicate with each other. If we're not social workers, we might be able to still help the kids find back their parents using a device or using technology. And today, so since November 2015, we've been able to be present in 25 countries through ambassadors, as I told you, have a community of 15,000 people with tech skills, creating projects on the ground to help the refugees. And we've had more than 3,000 entrepreneurs starting projects through our events. More than 450 refugees coming to our events and create technology with us, because it's great to create technology for the refugees, but it's also great and much better if you build it with them. Because at the end of the day, they are the one that are going to make the project sustainable, and they are the one that are going to use the technology. So yeah, I think I said enough. I mean, if you've seen the talk yesterday, so yeah, that's what we do. And if you have tech skills, I just invite you to join us. and to have that discussion on starting projects for refugees with refugees to empower them. Thank you.
Thank you, Joséphine. I'll invite now Alberto Alemanno to tell us all his secrets, how he's pushing society to take the reins on their own hands to make a difference.
Thank you, Antonio. Hello, everyone. I'm extremely pleased to be here with you. I'm a pretty life enthusiastic person. I like to share the energy that was naturally given to me. Yesterday, I met hundreds of young Portuguese in this room that gave me a lot of energy, so I feel even more energetic than usual. And some of you might look at me saying or wondering whether I'm a professional speaker, whether I'm a guru, whether I'm a psychologist. Well, you're going to be disappointed because I'm an academic. So I'm a university teacher. I've been teaching and studying for many years. But quite soon, when my dream realized to become a professor, the realization also came that the impact I had on society was very limited as compared to what I actually expected. And I soon start wondering whether, besides teaching, besides writing research, meaning trying to understand the world, I could actually do more in order to mobilize my desire for life and for sharing what I had. And I felt a sort of moral duty to actually make it happen, because I'm lucky, I'm privileged, and probably most of us in this room are in the same situation. And this moment of realization for me was an epiphany, in the sense that it really prompted to think how I could actually achieve what Joséphine just said, try to address this paradox that is really characterizing our society. On the one hand, we have never been better placed to change the state of the world because we are more educated, we are richer, we live longer than our ancestors. But on the other side, we actually do not make it happen and we are increasingly powerless. At this, we feel powerless, and especially when we face crises like the migration or social justices we've been discussing today. It is exactly at that time that I start reinventing my job and wondering whether how many people around the world were not feeling the same. And the answer that I got from my, let's say, friends, colleagues, different communities I spent time with really confirmed my hypothesis that it was not alone. Actually, it was in good company. And I felt, therefore, that both the problem, meaning the feeling of powerlessness, and the solution, meaning the expertise, the talent, and the resources, and the purpose to make it happen, they were both coexisting in society. So we need to match the problem with the solution. But the good story is that both elements are there in society. And that's basically the intuition behind the community that I started off also quite recently in 2015, the very same year as Techfugees, when we decided to create the Good Lobby. Why the Good Lobby? You might be also surprised about this apparently oxymoron. How can a lobby be good? Well, a lobby can be good because at the end of the day, what makes society very difficult today is the level of inequity, of unfairness into the system. So the Good Lobby is a community that tries to address such a problem by connecting individuals like you, who have a talent, who have an expertise, who have a particular cause you care about, with those individuals who actually need your expertise. I'm talking about pro bono. I'm talking about volunteering. But I'm not talking the regular pro bono. I'm not talking about a banker going to Indonesia to build a school. I'm not talking about a psychologist who is going to provide assistance in providing food or cooking, which is all fantastic activities. But I'm trying to develop a model of volunteering that is skill-based. I'm gonna give the chance to you to express yourself in your volunteering by tapping into your own potential, what you're really good at. Why don't you share that with society? So we have been, over the last 2 years, connecting volunteers with mainly civil society organizations, some grassroots movement, in order to collaborate in building bridges among entities and communities that usually do not talk one to another. So there are instances in which corporations can work with NGOs, there are instances in which academics can work with politicians, and why not? There might be situations in which politicians and citizens actually talk one another and work together. And this idea translates into projects that have an immediate impact. I mentioned to the Portuguese youth a few of them yesterday, and possibly one of the most interesting one for you is the work we have been doing on whistleblowing. So we have been trying to stimulate a debate in Europe, pushing the political parties at the European and national level to take a position on whether whistleblowers should or should not be protected. And that debate, in reality, led to the drafting of a first text, the first directive on Europe on protection of whistleblowers, and we got the ball rolling. And this is now part of the working program of the EU, and therefore also the member states are going to take over, and whistleblower has been put on the agenda. And we have been discussing, you just listened, possibly to the most famous whistleblower who is still alive. So it is by leveraging on the expertise of many people belonging to my community, which are citizens like you, that we managed to get this movement, and there are many coalitions, many entities, NGOs, civil societies who are actually working on this. Just wanted to give you an example of what we do, which is concrete and tangible.
To be current to what we said at the start of this, this panel, the raising of everybody around us, giving the power to people around us, make people belong, feel a hope in the world around them. It's quite amazing when we see Europe trying to deal with what we call the migrant crisis, an issue that we dedicate, we journalists, this weird animal group, every day we try to find leads and try to understand, they try to explain a story, as the people individual drama would be a story. There's a human being suffering, there's that mother that crosses the ocean. We never stop to think, I would say, most of us never stop to think, the biggest instinct of a mother is to protect her own child. She, without blinking their eyes, she will give her life instead of her baby. Anyone knows it. Nobody will dispute it. So how come, how do we dare to think that a mother that jumps into a boat, after leaving a hell behind her, bringing her dream of life with her, it's an invasor of our space? Which space? It's an invasor. And what can we gain in humanity together? Mandela used to tell us that we are as strong as the weakest of us. The strong, we are as strong as the weakest of us. And to be happy, I don't know if anyone knows this word in Africa called Ubuntu. Anyone knows what means Ubuntu? What does it mean? It is. Ubuntu is a common word on a different language in Africa. It's a sense of belonging. Nobody can be happy alone. Most of our lives, we try to be happy ourselves. And in reality, we know we cannot be happy if everybody will be miserable around us. And we have much more chances. Maybe the only way to be happy, it's if we take care of the people around us. For that, on that way, we'll have some chance of being happy. The other will never be. We'll be an island of loneliness. And we are digging that island around us every day with a shovel. And that shovel, it says, as. It's time for us to try to mend that space. It's our choice. They do it every day. And it takes nothing. Just a choice. It's a choice. It's ours. It's like zapping TV. I don't want to see more violence. I don't want to see more political people that say nothing. When I came back to Portugal after 16 years in Africa, I was invited to be a political editor. And I refused it blankly, because I would say I would be fired on the same day. And because I would just say, this politician said nothing. This one said nothing. Because they don't say most of the times nothing. And no journalist has the beep to say that they said nothing. And we keep repeating collections of nothings on the media. And we could publish books in name without nothing on them, full of politicians' speeches. And we don't notice. Maybe they would be bestsellers. Because TVs have massive audience of millions of people watching fools of nothing. It's almost obscene. And then the younger generation touches with a finger, and when we are sitting around the table, my two boys are chatting with each other. And we have a meeting, a family meeting with everybody. This sounds familiar to you. All of them, tick, 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 tick. It's a family gathering. And why not ride the technology in our advantage? Why should say, damn those bloody tablets and so forth. Why not take advantage? A brilliant mind guy called Donald Trump, don't throw me stones, learned to use that massive tool in his advantage. Why shouldn't we? Why shouldn't we? I will ask Joséphine I'm pushing her. I was asking because Joséphine dedicated a big part of her life, has been dedicated, not to visit the so-called refugees, to live with them. And I was asking, as a human being, not with my head a journalist, Joséphine, why do you think we Europeans close our doors to refugees? Because we are afraid they will bring bombs? Why, Joséphine? And
I have the answer, obviously, why we're doing this. no, but I think you've raised a point, which is, we're all in it together. The person who's going to tell you, like, I can't deal with that problem, I'm going to build a wall. We have climate change, right? And climate change will bring storms and will bring natural disasters. No wall will stop that. So we're all in it together, and if you want to consider the refugees not being part of your crew, you'll have to deal with it in another way. So, and to answer your question about why the Europeans closed the door, I mean, we know it's a lot of fear. There was also sort of instrumentalization of the media around that fear. But as I think I'll just take the word of one refugee who explained it to me the best, because I was really upset that the borders were closing. And as they were closing, he told me, he's from Syria, Aleppo. He told me, you know, don't be upset, Joséphine, because xenophobia, the fear of others, is something that people have. It's a human feeling. We fear. We fear the other. I'm afraid because I don't know them. And he personally didn't want to leave Syria, and it had no intention whatsoever, but because of the war, he had to flee. And he said to me, I was a xenophobe. I was like afraid of the others. I didn't like the others, foreigners and stuff. But I had to go. But I discovered that actually they're not so scary. He said, but so don't be upset at someone who feels this way because it's human natural feeling. But be upset at the populist. Be upset at the politician or at the people that are trying to make money out of that fear. And it's interesting, we had Nigel Farage earlier today, who's kind of that type of person, taking advantage of a feeling to put for a platform for his own political agenda. And this is more that person we have to be scared of than any of the refugees we're seeing. But don't be upset at anyone who's afraid of refugees or xenophobic as such, because it's just a matter of education and experience. Be upset at the people that are smart enough to use that fear against the others and divide. That's it, that's all I have to say.
Alberto, we were speaking about what you would like to see in a politician. Hmm. You were in the front, front run when Mr. Barroso was appointed. This is a clearly political, unpopular question, but it's the reality. Alberto became European known because he blasted Durão Barroso when he was appointed Goldman Sachs CEO. And he's got a very unique way of dealing with sort of attitudes from our political leaders.
Yeah, thank you, Antonio, for stimulating me on the issue of perceptions of politicians. Today, I think that we witnessed an interesting exchange earlier on when Baltazar Garzón legitimized in a sort of ex post rationalization why a judge could become a politician, which of course is a questionable point. But when he made such a point, he argued that we should stop saying that all politicians are the same, which is of course a very important point to make, not to fall into this kind of generalization. But at the same time, if we keep believing and repeating into the fact that politicians, the political class, they all are the same, is because somehow there are grounds justifying such a bias. So how can we change that? How can we change the perception of a political class of individuals who are expected to receive our delegated power, because the sovereignty is on us, we often forget is the citizens, we just delegate them for a short period of time, and then we should be able to take it back, but we just don't do it, because we don't do it in a rational way. So all political studies suggest that at the end of the day, our driver in electoral behavior is driven by identity nowadays. So why politicians should not then pay attention to their own identity and to the values they convey to us? And I think that's where there is hope. There is hope in a new class of political leaders acting both in traditional political parties but also in new movements who embrace values that are absolutely unacceptable for traditional politicians. I'm talking first of all about being compassionate and being empathic, the fact of putting yourself into the shoes you are expected to represent. Many people say that being too empathic might be bad for a decision maker, because you cannot be rational, right? How can you take a decision? But I prefer a very compassionate politician who can make a mistake rather than a very cold one. So political leaders should be compassionate, for sure, empathic, try to share the grief, try to understand what the other people you are expected to represent feel on their skin. That, I think, is a very important quality. But there are many others. Another one which I don't see much around is consistency. Consistency in the various arguments and points that politicians do make, but also consistency in their own personal life and professional life. So being consistent, and even better, be sober. Be sober in your behavior. If you've been a very successful political leader, and you had several in this country, like in many others, you don't need, when you retire, to keep be attached to that status and power. You actually should live in a society that reward you if you make a step back by saying, I did my contribution, and now I'm gonna watch, read books, and watch movies. That would be fantastic to live in such a society, but possibly we are not there. Such a cultural transformation hasn't occurred yet. Living in a world in which the default is the default for good, is not the default for bad. Now we live in a society where all the defaults, so all what we are longing for, is the wrong thing. What about changing the role models? I love role models because they are extremely powerful in translating this value into something visible. Being a football player is super cool. Going in TV is super cool. But what if also being a teacher in primary school could be as cool as being a football player? I'm giving you an example of defaults for good. And we can keep thinking about how we can celebrate these role models by creating them, because we are, in a way, absolutely in control of opting out of these defaults by saying, I don't buy into this, I don't use social media in such a way as a consumer, I'm gonna use social media as a citizen by making my voice heard, by really having an impact, instead of becoming only passive or part of a system. And I see a lot of consumerism and very little citizenship or citizenry around those issues, around our individual choices. And of course, change starts from each of us. Each of us can trigger such a habit-forming process that can turn something bad into something positive, just for magic.
Time. We just had advice here. We have to finish in 5 minutes, turning it around. We'd invite anybody, if you want to put a question to any of the guests here.
Okay.
Let's try, Alberto, let's try to be
short.
Hello. Hello, Alberto, I'd like to make you a question. So as I understood, because I listened yesterday, like just 5 minutes, I'm sorry, the end of your presentation, you help NGOs to be some kind of policy makers instead of only policy takers, if I can use this expression. That would bring the politicians to be accountable for some of their decisions. What do you think about organizations, profit organizations? Do you think that they also have a role in this kind of accountability for politicians? They will be influenced in the future by their politics. Don't you think that organizations should be in relation with the politicians, with the political decision makers, in order to make them know what are the profit organizations will, what they want to, in order for the politicians to be able to influence them in the future in the most positive way? Thank you.
Albert.
Yeah, you're absolutely spot on. I think the future of the political debate will occur in this disconnect between the representatives and the citizens. And that space for the time being has not been occupied by many actors because traditional parties do not want to occupy that space in between elections. They get very excited between elections and they forget the citizens for 5 years and they're going to come back to you. That space now is very much animated by self-proclaimed direct democracy movements that you see emerging around Europe that haven't really delivered on their promise of accountability and inclusiveness, and then by online petition platforms and click activism that is giving you the illusion to be part of that conversation and therefore putting pressure on the politicians. There's a positive side of this, but there's a risk of manipulation at the same time. So I'm very critical of this commodification of civic participation through, digital use of big data and collection of signature. But this is the space, and I hope there will be more movements capable of occupying that space and connecting political leaders with citizens in a more constructive dialogue, because that's exactly what we miss today. We don't even know the name of our political representatives. We have so many at the municipal level, at the regional level, at the national level, at the European level. So how can you know all of them?
Thank you, Alberto. Thank you, Josephine. Let's start to be the change we want for the world. Thank you so much for your presence here.